with Leonard Corrigan, who one of the committee members. Leonard, this probably has been a very difficult task for you to get it to this point.
Delighted to get it this far, Brian, no doubt about it. It was a bit of an effort, all right. And those who couldn't come or didn't come, well, I don't think they know what they're missing. But great to be here, and everybody looking good, Brian.
So good.
And 50 years on from it started in 66, but you started just 1 year after that.
We were the next year, yes. We weren't the first year, Brian. We were 67, and 67 to 72, that's when we did. First 3 years all boys, and then we joined the girls then for the last two, and that's when Mr. Fitzpatrick and others sort of featured big time then. Right.
Yeah, well, there was that, of course, the national school that we attended prior to the comprehensive, it was an all-boys school, so they probably ease us in slowly into the female gender.
Yes, it is in situation, Brian, yes. So it took a bit of handling on it now. Some of us got on better than others. I should say some of them got on better than us, but anyway, yes, Brian, it was a big change, big culture change for us.
And of course, you're meeting people now that you mightn't have met from 1972, or in my case, 1970. So how would you feel that some of them have, let's say, weathered?
I have to say, Brian, they're all looking as if they had much less stress in their lives than I've had, all looking very good, and we could recognise them straight away as they came in, you know. Even people like yourself or Mr. Fitzpatrick here, who really, you know, haven't changed very much. You're still the crooks that you were in those days, you know, but you've smoothed out well, I have to say. But the girls in particular, all looking well. Sadly, we've lost a few of our friends and fellow classmates, like my good friend John Fye, who was a hairdresser, we call him Fye the Barber, sadly gone since 2003. James Lidko, another good man from up Mountain Lodge direction, and we had Joseph Kyle from Tully Coe and Marion Boyle from Boff outside the town, all gone to another place that maybe hopefully we'll link up someday. They're gone ahead of us, sadly, but that's it.
Yeah, that's always a sad situation in meeting up people recalling who were friends at the time. But also, this work didn't take place without people supporting you. So you had a committee. When did the committee start organising the function?
We started about February 1st, Brian, and starting putting things together. It was Fiacra had the idea of getting our class doing our thing with it. The school as a whole, obviously, is a much bigger undertaking. But from February on, and we'd meet then maybe once a month, and then as time went on, coming near the deadline, the meetings were more frequent as it came together. And this is what we have today. Sadly, not as good a turnout as I would have expected, but, you know, everyone moves on. We're scattered to the four corners of the world, and anyone that was available to come came along, and we're delighted to see everybody today.
You know, the important thing is that there is a good a set of activities, plus the dinner dance later on tonight, and there'll probably be a larger turnout for that.
Yes, I think it's envisaged, Brian. A full house is 400, so it's well over the threes at the minute. I think it's about 350 or whatever. So that's it was a surge in the take-up of tickets later as the time drew near. Lots of activities in the school over the weekend, and music and arts stuff, and just a lovely weekend, and a great effort made by the school, the teachers and the students, to have it looking so well and open for us all to see and enjoy.
And that's brilliant, Leonard. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian.
Heather Humphreys, Minister, you are visiting your alma mater. Very impressive display for the 50th anniversary.
Absolutely fantastic display here. I'm delighted to be back in my old school, and of course it brings back many, many happy memories, and it's great to see the photographs and you know, meeting old schoolmates. In fact, I met one of my classmates there when I came in through the door, and it's good to have a chat and just to catch up. So it's a great weekend for the school to see so many taking the time to come back, and indeed one past pupil has travelled all the way from Philadelphia. In fact, I met him last weekend at the family commemorations, and he's here to join in the celebrations of 50 years of St. Aidan's Comprehensive in Cootehill.
Of course, this school was groundbreaking in a sense, in that it was one of the first comprehensives in Ireland, and it also was co-ed and multi-denominational. So that has probably helped education in Ireland from its inception in 66.
Absolutely, and this of course was a pioneering school. Comprehensive school was one of the first of its kind here in Cootehill, and we have to pay a tribute to those that had the vision to start this school at the time. And it certainly was a co-ed, and it was co-different religions here, and I really do believe that it gave us all a very good understanding of different communities within this area. And I certainly feel that co-education is certainly the way forward and brings benefits, because we had everybody here working together. We were all studying, and of course the things that kept us together were the common things, like all children, a day off school or no homework was the most important thing to us all at that time.
Now, most of us are recalling some of the, we could call, key moments, not necessarily educational moments. Maybe you'd like to recall some of the fun moments or some of the key events that you can recall from being here.
Yeah, there were many events, many, many happy days, and of course Brian O'Mora was the headmaster here at the time, and we used to play handball out in or rounders, or indeed whatever sport was on. And I suppose some of the funny times were when we may have had a free class, and of course we were all high spirited, and the headmaster would come in and perhaps try to calm us down in his own very innate way. And we had many plays. We had, of course, we called them the hop. Was the local annual disco that we had at the time, and there was many going ons there, but I'll not go into the details of those.
Minister Humphreys, it's nice to see you back at the St Aidan Comprehensive in Cootehill. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're at the 20th anniversary of the Comprehensive School. I've caught up one of the ex-pupils, Michael Fitzpatrick. Maybe you'd run through some of the highlights of your time in the Comprehensive.
The only thing I'll think about the Comprehensive was when I was qualified as a solicitor, right, was sitting in the bar council in Dublin, in the forecourts, right, and a fella said to me one day, "Where did you go to school?" And I said, "I went to the school in the Comprehensive in Cootehill." "Oh, you went to a Comprehensive?" And I says, "Yeah." He says, "You did very well for a fella that went for a Comprehensive." I told him, anybody can go to a Comprehensive and go anywhere as far as you like. That's what I liked about it.
So there was a little bit of elitism with some, or some people call it snobbery. Well, you spent 5 years there. Some of your comical moments?
They were all comical. I remember a few with you. Well, Moore kicked the hell out of him. No, we better not mention that. No,
we better not.
You caught me on the hop now, thinking about comical moments. Right.
Of course, we progressed from National School. I have a few more people to speak to. Leonard was on the committee, Leonard Corrigan. Of course, Faker's chairman, we'll be talking to him later. But we passed through from the National School on to the Comprehensive.
Okay.
We were in the same class. And it was an all-boys class now. How did that sit with you? Because you would have possibly preferred a mixed class.
Oh, you can bet your life on that one. And that's why I was so happy when we went into third year, because there was women in the class.
Oh, well, I had left before
because,
that time.
Do you know what the reason? Because they had an influence on my life. That's why I have actually progressed so well. It was the women in the class that influenced the rest of my life.
So they took the best out of you?
Hopefully. if there is any.
And of course, this very enterprising. Of course, you possibly recall cycling to Clonus, remember, to get squibs that were sold illicitly in the Comprehensive. So that
no,
was the
we
start.
Wouldn't do anything illicit.
Oh well, that was the start of your entrepreneurial flair, was
no,
it?
I'm like Trump. I deny everything. it's a setup. That's what it is. But what I was thinking about, while you were talking about cycling, everybody used to cycle to the Comprehensive, right?
Yeah.
Now they get buses and only live down the road.
Ah, so society has changed quite a bit.
I remember your bicycle.
I remember somebody driving over the wheel. Are you admitting to it now? Yeah.
It was me.
See, that's the sort of thing that, you know, when you're young and impressionable, you were considered a townie, so you were, because I lived out
well,
in the country.
Well, see, it was half and half.
Yeah.
We lived on the one leg was in the country and the other leg was in the thing. But the only thing I remember was Leonard Carrigan, he was very posh at school because he always had nice clothes.
And a tie.
And, yeah, and really well dressed. And he had this corgi, which would now be considered a designer dog. You know, like Paris Hilton has her designer dog. Yeah. A corgi at that day. He was very posh, that Carrigan fella.
Ah, yeah, well,
all I ever had to wear to school was me brothers, because I had six of them. What do you call them?
Hand-me-downs.
Hand-me-downs. That's all I ever had.
Yeah.
I'm still going out of Vincent the Paul.
The Paul and Vincent now, they have some very good shops that they have. I think that, hopefully we'll catch up with you again, maybe at later on tonight. And
when it's over up.
When you get the opportunity to be a bit more coherent and get a few more words strung together.
Are you on the drink as well?
Not just quite at the moment, no. So that's it. That's one of how could we describe him?
A renegade.
Ah, no, that would have to be more endearing in our terminology.
But do you know how I actually have to comprehend it?
The guards, was that what...
No, Dolores O'Donnell chased me out of it with a hurley stick.
Oh.
That's the last time I left the comprehensive, out the gate and over after me with a hurley stick. Well, actually, it was a camogie stick, I think. Is there a difference?
There is a difference, yeah.
Yeah, but I think she thought she was a hurler.
So that's only some of the life that this poor student experienced. At 50 years is a long time.
Isn't it? Where did it go?
You're not.
I still think I'm 27.
I think you went to the school when you were about three, didn't you?
No. It wasn't three. It could two and a half, I think, maybe, something like that.
Yeah, feeling because
the only thing about it was, you see, I was five when I was born.
Oh, right. A real smart arse from the very beginning, yeah. So there's more to come, and there's better to come from Michael Fitzpatrick.
No, Stike. Stike.
Oh, Stike, yeah.
This is the first time I've been called Stike in 30 years. Rosemary came in and she says, "How are you, Stike?" I was called Stike, that's my nickname, since I was 4 years of age.
Oh, well, with a name...
Nobody knew who the hell I was.
Ah. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. It was so sad. They didn't even know it was Fitzpatrick.
No,
It was like fuck. It was like what he.
Oh, sorry.
It was like the Italian jobby. There's Lolo or whatever her name is. Lala.
Oh. You know, and all the social welfare payments went to Stike care of the comprehensive. A unique experience for this gentleman.
Good to see you, uncle. You're looking well.
We're with Georgina Chambers. You're a part of the committee that was helping to organise the event.
Well, I was really only on the peripheries when Fairker rang me a few months back. To say him and Leonard were thinking of organising this little roundup, and I was immediately scared of, you know, what this involved and so on. So I thought about it for a month or so, and then decided, well, yes, could be a good idea, having not seen everybody for 50 years. So it was only a couple of weeks ago, really, that I actually finally made up my mind that we'll give it a go. And sure, here we are, and it's absolutely fantastic seeing everybody again, and going over the stories, going over the things that happened, and it's great.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Bless us, O God, as we sit together. Bless the food we're about to eat. Bless the hands that made the food. Bless us, O God, in it. Enjoy your meal, everyone. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Everyone, on behalf of the Board of Management, teachers, staff, it's my honour and pleasure to welcome you here tonight. I've been associated with St. Aidan's for almost 30 years and delighted to see this weekend honouring 50 years of the school. I hope you won't enjoy the weekend celebrations. It gives me great pleasure to introduce a past pupil of the school, our local TD and Minister for Arts, Heritage, Regional Culture and Gaelic Affairs, Ms. Helen Pupils.
Deputy Brendan Smith, Senator Joe O'Reilly, ladies and gentlemen, it's an absolute pleasure to be here this evening to join you all in celebrating the 50th anniversary of the opening of the Aidan's. And it has been a year of commemoration, and I'm delighted to be taking part in another one so close to home. When I started in first year in the comprehensive at the earliest age of 12, I had come from a small rural primary school with just one teacher in a single classroom, and there were two other people in my class, including myself. In contrast to St. Aidan's, of course, which was a big modern school with lots of classrooms, a troop of ambitious young teachers who wanted to open our young minds to the outside world. I'm delighted to see some of those teachers here tonight who, like myself, are a little less youthful, but I am sure you're just as ambitious. St. Aidan's was a fantastic melting pot where we all got along and had aspirations like all other school children, a day off school or no homework. My time at the camp encouraged my sense of curiosity, helped me foster a love of current affairs and politics, and broaden my mind through discussion and debate. Geraldine O'Brien, my economics teacher, Joan Hannan, my English teacher, and Hugh O'Brien, my history teacher, all had a huge impact on me. They encouraged me to speak up and speak out, and I'm still doing it today. My greatest achievement at St. Aidan's was when I and the other members of the debating team, Siobhan O'Donnell, now McCabe, Oliver Smith and Michelle Lynch, under the stewardship of Joan Hannan, beat the Belvedere Boys in the Junior Chamber of Commerce League. It was quite something for their country kids to beat the Belvedere Boys, and I think it came as something of a shock to our Dublin counterparts. St. Aidan's introduced me to the world of arts and literature, and little did I know at the time that this would serve me well several decades later in my role as Arts Minister. So all this praise for my former teachers might create the impression that I was an ideal student, which of course I wasn't. I was more than capable of getting into plenty of mischief, But thankfully, I was also fairly good at getting out of it. And most importantly, I rarely got caught. Some would say the artful dodger. I must have been preparing for politics. Is also a past pupil, but naturally enough, he was years ahead of me, and I'm delighted to see Joe here this evening. I have many, many fond memories, as I know all of you do, of my time in St. Aidan's. I made friends for life, not just with fellow pupils, but even with my teachers. The comprehensive ethos of the school allowed us to realise that we had much more in common than divided us. For a school in a small town in a rural county just south of the border, St. Aidan's was a wonderfully open and inclusive environment. And it's been a great honour for me to return to the school in recent years, first as the local credit union manager, then as a TD, and more recently as a minister. I was particularly proud to attend the school's commemorative event as part of the 1916 commemorations earlier this year and to return for the opening of the new classrooms. I always feel at home in St. Aidan's, and I would like to pay a special tribute to the current principal, Mary Ann Smith, and all the teachers. You're doing a fantastic job at educating your current crop of students. So, I hope you all enjoy the evening. You get a chance to recount some old stories and to renew old acquaintances. So have a great evening. Enjoy it. Gura míle maith agaibh.
We've caught up with Seamus Reynolds, who was with St. Aidan's, or the Comp as they called it, from the very beginning. Seamus, maybe you'd run through some of your experiences with this new form of education that was deemed in 1966.
Well, I came to Cootehill in September 1966, and I'd seen an ad on the paper for a position in the comprehensive schools. The comprehensive schools were set up really arising from the investment in education report in the early 60s. Because there was at that stage there was an imbalance between technical education and academic type schools, and it was becoming increasingly obvious to the government and to those people who were looking into this that we didn't have enough technical education. So the idea was to kind of marry the two systems, the academic and the technical. So when the comprehensives were opened here in Bray, I live in Bray, that's why I said Bray, here in Cootehill, for example, there was a secondary school and a vocational school. So the idea was to amalgamate the two of those and then to open the new comprehensive. I'm not quite certain why this town was selected at the time. Maybe that there was and I suppose there was an absence of second level education generally in the area, and they introduced free education that year as well, and school transport. So we got a huge influx into the comprehensive when it first opened. The department had estimated that there'd be, I think, 150 first years, and actually there was an excess of 250. And this was a whole new experience. Because one of the basic principles of comprehensive education was that you taught students in mixed ability groups. In other words, you didn't stream people on ability. And most schools, well, certainly most secondary schools did that at the time. You know, they graded the pupils on the basis of an entrance exam. And that was a fairly iniquitous system in that very often the worst classes got the worst teachers. There was segregation of teachers as well. So we had this new idea of the comprehensive school. Another thing that I hadn't encountered previously was that we had children from various religious denominations coming in. And I had very little experience with that because I came from Roscommon, and I don't think there was one single family in the whole parish that wasn't Catholic. So I came here to Cootehill to discover that, you know, we had up to 30% of the student population who weren't Catholic. And that was an eye-opener for me in that there was never any tensions between the various denominations. And indeed, I would have been teaching in classes in those early days, and I wouldn't have a clue whether children, what denomination they came from. So that was refreshing to see that. And I always, from my experience there, I always felt that it was a great pity that we didn't have more of those type of schools, particularly in Northern Ireland. And it might have eased some of the tensions between the various denominational groups if at least they were mixing in schools.
So you stayed with the comprehensive teaching, and as you said, you found it very enriching and engaging with the variety of people, both interdenominational and mixed gender as well. So how did you see that it developed, you know, where there was a certain association with people going to university from certain secondary schools where technical people went to trades? How did you feel that the comprehensive type of education fitted into both the university and the technical side of things?
Well, we very quickly established a very high standard in the school, a very high academic standard, and we were achieving very quickly in the early years of the school, we were achieving very good Leaving Cert results, and a lot of our people were going to university. So it gained general acceptance in the community here. And for example, I sent my own children to the comprehensive school, and most of the teachers did. And that was a tremendous testament to the success of the school, that the teachers themselves were sending their children there. And when other families in the area saw that the teachers were sending their children there, they sent their own children. And really, after about 5 or 6 years, I think the vast majority of children going to second level in this area came to the comprehensive. They were not going to Pats and Cavan, or they weren't going to Monaghan, or they weren't going to other second level schools. They were coming here, and I think that's an indication of how successful the school was.
We had also Minister Humphreys, who was also a keynote speaker tonight, but an ex-pupil of the comprehensive. So she spoke highly of the school. So you would feel that the education was able to fulfil any role that people were willing to take in their further education.
Well, very much so, because I went on. I was vice principal in the school from February of 1967. And then I went as principal down to Carlow Vocational School, and then I subsequently became CEO in Bray and County Wicklow. So I saw a lot of schools over the years, and I don't think I ever encountered a school in all my experience where teachers worked as hard and embraced the whole concept of mixed ability and extracurricular work as they did in the comprehensive school, particularly in the early days. And we taught in those days on Saturday mornings as well as the 5 days of the week, and staff meetings went on into the night sometimes, and there was huge enthusiasm for this new project, and as I say, signs on in the success that the school achieved.
While education, it was a new concept, but there also must have been some areas, and we have to dwell on some of the comical side and some of the things that would have stood out from your point of view, not necessarily from an educational point of view, but I'm sure you must have encountered some students that challenged you. And so from that point of view, what would your most memorable times, both on the comical side of things and teaching challenging wise, what would they be?
Well, I suppose if you're a teacher, the biggest challenge you always face is the lack of interest by students in what you're teaching them. And I suppose any teacher who is honest will say that very often, even today, the educational system doesn't prepare people for many aspects of life. And some of the most successful people you meet in afterlife were not good academically in school or didn't achieve very well in school. But we weren't developing those entrepreneurial talents that they had and so on. And no school is, maybe, to this day, some of those things develop afterwards. But, you know, when I think back on those things afterwards, and I had a role as vice principal, I had a role in discipline in the school. But, and I always felt if you had a good sense of humor and you didn't take that too seriously, because by and large, the students that you were dealing with were doing nothing worse than you ever did when you were in school yourself. But you couldn't let them know that. You pretended you were horrified at what they were doing and so on. But overall, it was maybe times have changed. And from what I hear nowadays in some schools, they have changed. With drug culture and various stuff like that happening. But in those days, a lot of it was fairly innocent stuff. And because of the introduction of free education and free transport, there was great appreciation in the early days of education and how important it was. So I think that certainly in my early days in the school, I saw that sort of enthusiasm there reflected in good discipline generally, and we had many comical instances in the school, but they would be the normal sort of pranks that youngsters would get up to, and none of them were ever very serious. I remember one particular incident where when you think about it now, at the time it caused great ripples around the place. A guy was bringing in contraceptives from Northern Ireland and selling them, and you know, nowadays that would be regarded probably as harmless enough, but at that stage it was almost a hanging offence. And needless to say, he was suspended and warned about his future conduct, and I suppose that was the end of that. And you know, the normal peccadillos that young fellas get up to in school, we had lots of those, but nothing that serious.
So you're mingling with former students tonight, and I'm sure they're recalling some incidents that you may not necessarily remember. Yeah. But the engagement tonight, it must be pleasing to you, because you've been instrumental in their educational process that brought them to maybe gainful employment. So tonight it must be special for you when so many people are recalling their incidents with you as a mentor and a teacher and a leader to them.
Absolutely. Now, I always think, though, that students sometimes, as they get older and as they, if they have been successful in life themselves, they sometimes look back on their experiences with teachers through rose-tinted spectacles a bit, and they forget maybe about some of the bad experiences they had, and they prefer to remember the good ones. But yeah, it's always nice to meet people who have succeeded. And it's even nicer sometimes to maybe meet people who haven't succeeded that well, who will say, well, it wasn't your fault. It was my fault because I didn't listen to you or I wasn't interested at the time. But I always love to meet past pupils in any capacity like that. And it's particularly refreshing when they're complimenting you and their experiences with you and so on.
So your experience at the 50th anniversary, which seems quite a long time now, it's rewarding to see so many people that hold you within affection, and some may not, but indeed, once to discuss it with you, you can get all those issues resolved.
Yeah, well, nobody has expressed any contrary view to me tonight anyway, and maybe they're all in a good mood. But, you know, I'm glad I came down tonight, and I went out of my way to come down, because I think it's I always like to keep in touch with my own college that I went, where I went to college myself, and we have reunions all the time, and I'm involved still with them. And with the comprehensive here, as I say, any time I'm down this area, I'll call. I'm always delighted to keep up old contacts. Unfortunately, a lot of the colleagues who started with me are no longer with us, and that's sad.
Seamus Rallon, thank you for speaking to IrishWebTV.com, and hopefully the night will give you further rewards.
Thank you very much.
We've caught up with Benny Ago, or as we knew him in earlier, Bernard Ago. So Bernard, give us some of your recollections of your period in St Aidan's.
Do you want the really good ones?
The very best.
What about you?
Absolutely not.
Button accordions. Do you remember the button accordion there in St Michael's Hall?
I have recollections of it, but Daddy, there was no social media at that time, so there's no record.
We couldn't get.
But please,
the accordion you started playing at a concert from the comp, and the buttons went all over the place. Do you remember that?
I certainly do. And as a young guy from the country, you were from the town because you lived on Station Road, just beside where the comprehensive was built. And I was mortified. But you must have more memories.
I have, but we were highly entertained by that one. That was very. Memories from 150 years. I remember the comprehensive before it was ever built. And Mrs. Farley lived across the road from us on the site of the comprehensive. And she was a very old woman. She had a bit of an orchard. And we used to go up and pick the apples for her, take them down, and my mother would make an apple tart and bring it up to Mrs. Farley. And Mrs. Farley lived on apple tarts, biscuits, and 7-Up. She used to go down and buy the biscuits and the 7-Up in
Corrigan shop. Was it Corrigan?
As far as Corrigan shop, she Mrs. Gamble's, a wee shop there, Ali Gamble's mother. And but she died, and the minute she died, Monsignor Fitzpatrick said, "Right, there's a site for the school." And the bulldozer wee house, it was a tiny little house with a bridge across the road, and built the school on that. I can just remember going, building, and I'm going to school. And I was only 11 or 12 at the time, but I always remember Mrs. Farley. I used to tell people for years and years, probably for 40 years after that, Mrs. Farley's ghost was walking up and down the corridors of school. I used to just tell her as a bit of a joke, but today I thought she was there.
All right.
When I was walking up and down the car, I thought she was going up and down it too. She probably was.
Yeah, so you moved from St. Michael's by school to the comprehensive in, that would have been 67, a year after it opened. And a couple of us, and you met with some of us tonight, who travelled the educational route through the National School onto the comprehensive. But you were considered, as we said, the brains of the of the operation.
Wait a minute, Leonard Corrigan just put you up to the city. Where was that all day? We had a very, very good class from we started off. You remember that. It was from we left the National School under Earl. We started off first, second class under Fitzpatrick or Fitz. He was a neighbour of yours.
He was.
He didn't teach us much, and nobody could teach us much. But we moved on up to the comprehensive, and we went out there, and so we thought, you thought you were from the country, but you were from the town, the same as the rest of us. That we were the bee's knees when we got out there. We were the town. The other boys were from the sticks.
But at that time, said education had changed. We weren't aware of the changes. While we moved from a national school that was all male, and we moved on our first period of time in the comprehensive was an all male class. But then you moved on during leaving cert years to a mixed, and it was multi-denominational, and How would you have found that, you know, was it that challenging to you when in your early teens?
No, definitely not multi-denominational. I think we got on exceptionally well with all religions. We all did. I mean, it was as if somebody had opened this place for us to go and be ourselves and do what our parents all once wanted to do. None of our parents wanted to be separatists or didn't want to be nationalists or unionists. We just wanted to be people. And we got a chance to do that when we went to Comprehensive. Oh, by Jesus, we loved it. We really loved that. We were all the boys' class. And all that mattered to us was who was better at basketball or who was better at handball. Or it didn't make a bit of difference whether you were Catholic, Protestant. Well, we didn't have Jews, or we just played Catholic and Protestant. We didn't know who was who until we went to religious class. But that was grand for the first 3 years when we were all boys. But as Leonard Currigan says, after year three, when the hormones were starting to crunch in, they put us in with a load of women. They weren't women at the time, they were girls. We hadn't a clue where to put ourselves. For 2 years or 2.5 years, it was absolute hell. I mean, seriously hell. For young fellas.
I left to go to employment
yes,
before.
You were
and it was in a mixed environment. But you would have found that your experiences in that did help you in you know, as time developed and as you developed as a person. Those experiences did ultimately help you.
I'm not quite sure whether they helped, Brian, but they were there to test me. I mean, seriously test me, because I was very shy. I mean, 14, 15, 16, whatever age you get to. And everything changes when you go from an all-boys to a mixed class. But it was, I'm sure it was a help for later on, but for me, I'm not sure whether it was or not.
But tonight now, you're meeting with former colleagues, some meeting you saying, hello, Bernd or Benny, and possibly might recognise them. Some maybe you recognise that they don't recognise. So it must be, tonight must be a completely different experience for you, encountering people that you hadn't met in even maybe up to 50 years.
It must be close. Well, I think it's 44 years since we left school, something like that. So it's a long, long time to not even see somebody. And then to see them for the first time today and realise that, you know, God, they were the kids I went to school with. It was brilliant. It really was absolutely brilliant. I loved every minute out in Argies today. It was sensational. And to see Georgina Chambers brought us photographs of the year we did the leaving. And just try and recognise people. The people I know really well now, and I couldn't recognise in the pictures.
So they changed over the years. But the stories now, you know, you're going to meet probably a lot more later on. So it must be enlightening for you to be able to meet with those people and recall some of the good times. You must, what we've discussed, in every situation like this, you said you were in your teens, and there must be some very funny stories, or at least one or two funny stories that you'd like to recall.
I can't recall any funny story, and I'm not telling any. I'm seriously not, because people were telling me stories today, and I was saying, no, I wasn't there, I don't remember it. Seriously, one of the stories was, I was drunk coming home on a bus from Playboy in the Western World in Dublin, and this all sounded great, only I didn't drink, so I may have been asleep on the bus or sick on the bus or whatever, but I certainly wasn't drunk, and I'd have liked to be drunk. But I mean, at that stage, I was probably 16 or 17 or whatever it was, I didn't have access to money to get drunk.
It's part mythology or something. And as I've said, Benny was, or Bernard was, the model student, so obviously we have to take at face value. And he's in with a fair element of...
No, I wouldn't tell you any lies, Brian, no. I always thought people would say school years are the best years of my life, we're telling lies, because I've had really, really good years since then. And I can't remember that many good years at school. But I can't remember any. I can't remember a single bad moment at school. Not one single moment that was bad when I was in the 5 years in the comprehensive. So what does that say? I can't remember anything really joyous or good, but they were happy, good days. Not the happiest years of my life. I hope not, because I'm hoping to have the happiest years of my life ahead of me. Yeah.
So, but you're looking. In fondness with your experience of that time, and now tonight meeting people who you may not have met. So so Benny or Bernard, as we always call you, but now subsequent Benny, Bernard, it's lovely to talk to you after such a time. And
but I have to tell everybody who's going to see this now, I have to tell them how you performed when you were in school. You, I don't know whether you ever patented what you did, but you should have. You used to get lines. We all used to get lines. And you created a pen, a five-pen pen, so that you could write five lines at the time. You remember that?
I certainly do, yeah.
Until Pat Ryan twigged this, and he started giving you lines from the Bible. Do you remember that?
I certainly do. But, you know, enterprise, you have to think outside the box, and certainly... An education is supposed to do that.
But you had five different coloured pens. You should have used the same coloured pen. Do you remember?
And that you're able to recall that. And that's some of the experiences that we had at a brilliant school in St. Aidan's.
She's going to cut, yeah. I could talk to you all day, Brian. And I couldn't do it to anybody else, because...
I've just caught up with James Goldrick. James, you were at the very early stages of the comprehensive school in Cootehill. Maybe you would outline how you evolved into the first comprehensive school in Ireland.
Well, it was one of four. It was one of the first open. There were four actually at that stage. There was one in Glenties, number two. There was one in Carrow, and there's one down in Shannon. So they'd hoped to spread them around the country because it was a new venture. But I had been in Cootehill prior to 1966. I worked in St. Michael's Secondary School. It was a private secondary school, and it had the parents in general came together because they wished to have the access to the leaving cert. And they formed a limited company, which was very unusual, and the school was very successful. But when 1966 came along, we were assimilated because we were hoping to build a new school, and obviously when the comprehensive came, we all turned over into it, pupils, staff and the lot.
Now, as people, as viewers can gather from your accent, you're not native to the county.
No. I'm from Donegal. I taught in Cleary's, the Four Masters High School in Donegal, for 4 years prior to coming to Cootehill. So I came to Cootehill actually for 1 year, so I'm still there. It was a good spot, and it's a case where you put your roots down, so it was a very happy long term for me.
But have you said it was a whole new educational system, in a sense, in with comprehensive education, that it was multi-denominational, co-ed. How did you, you know, it must have been new for you, and how did you feel of that new concept of education at the time?
Well, strange enough, Donegal Town was something similar. It was mixed, like boys and girls, co-ed, multi-denominational, and when we came to St. Michael's, we had something very similar there. So it wasn't a strange departure for me, like it was a fairly normal development, and I found it a very natural sequence within the comprehensive system. They were mixed, everything, religious, boys and girls together, and it worked like a dream, I must say. And the department, they were apprehensive in the beginning, because they had limited experience, because secondary education was mostly VEC, and the ordinary straight secondary school run by the religious. So this really was their first venture into it. And they were cautious in the beginning, but after 2 years they did a review, so they said they were highly pleased with the results, the overall results of the comprehensives. They were highly supported by the parents, and results were good. Staff were over eager. There was a special payment to staff in the comprehensive in the beginning to encourage staff to stay, but they discontinued then after some time. But the general development of the comprehensive structure, it worked like a dream. So I was pleased with it, because otherwise I never would have stayed in it. And my own family went through the comprehensive, and they were very happy with it, and went to third level afterwards and achieved highly. So there was no reason for me not to support it highly.
And what I have to say to you viewers was that 15 minutes ago I asked James to... for this interview, and with the high esteem that had been held in, it took that period of time, with all the congratulations, all the conversations he had with ex-pupils, to get to this point where we're able to speak to him. So James, you're held in great regard, and you progressed through the career structure within the comprehensive system.
Yes, I was a vice principal for 18 years. I was made a vice principal my second year there, and then I was principal for 14 years, so I spent 30 plus years there, and there were 30 very, very happy years, and I never had any reason to feel that I should leave it, and I'm happy that I spent my time there, because it was a great development.
Now, in any situation, you're dealing with younger people, the hormones are developing, there must have been some very... funny situations that you have encountered. Maybe you'd recall to us some of your more joyous moments within the education system.
Well, I've met a lot of past pupils there tonight, from the age of 60 right down, and each and every one of them is emphasising how happy their days were. And sometimes you feel that days at school are not that happy. I boarded myself in a boarding school, and I must say we had a lot of unhappy days, because the discipline was rigid, but very, very strict, and it didn't suit everybody. But in the comprehensive, the discipline wasn't extremely rigid. They got a certain amount of freedom, but they were able to cope with it, and it worked out very well, because I never would be one for very rigid discipline. You have to give young people a certain amount of liberty and freedom, and as long as they don't overuse or overabuse it, it works well.
As a border county person from Donegal, moving to another border county in Cavan, would you have felt that experience that you had in your native county would have been a great help to you coming to Cavan?
I would have to agree with you. It was totally ideal, because the type of pupil that I met here, they were exactly the same as the pupils in Donegal, mostly from small farmers, highly motivated, anxious to succeed, and very easy to manage and to handle. So I saw very little difference between life here in Cavan and life in Donegal, very similar, and the schools the same. So it wasn't a difficult experience for me to readjust. I would have to say, like, the students were of a high quality.
Now, of course, education is in the news at the moment. Yes. And how would you see that education had developed over time? And what would your views be on how education can develop into the future?
I can see the introduction of practicals, all this project work. There must be a lot of emphasis on that. And we see less emphasis on rote learning. But it's going in the right direction, and I have no reason to feel, you know, that I won't succeed and continue. There's really not very much wrong with the old structure of education, both the Leaving Cert and the Junior Cert, but they need to be reformed, and you need more practicals, more assessment, and more orals.
Now, we spoke to some of the people, ex-pupils here, that have achieved high level. Would you feel that the comprehensive style of education would have benefited people who may have not have had the access to that third level education if they had stuck with the earlier type of education system?
Yes, you know, the fact that all of them didn't go to third level. Some of the people that didn't go to third level, you know, achieved very highly and were very successful business people. They went out in life, they made a good life for themselves, and they didn't seem to lack the fact that they didn't go to third level. Those that went to third level from the comprehensive, they more than held their own with the top students from other secondary schools, because, you know, I have a number of them in mind that, you know, they went on and did their PhDs the same as the rest. All of them didn't do it, but quite a few of them did, and they came back to say that the first year they kept their heads down in third level, but once they found that they were able to hold their own, and more than hold their own, they felt more than comfortable.
Yeah, well, we spoke to Minister Humphreys earlier on, and she is now a key person within the political system in Ireland, delivering a lot of services locally to communities. So you would have remembered her passing through the educational system in Cootehill?
Yes, I remember. I remember Heather very well, and Joe was there tonight too, Joe Riley. All of these people passed through the structure, and they obviously benefited a lot from it. From both the teaching and the general ethos around the place, and I have no reason to feel that a lot of others, maybe they didn't get the same level of publicity, you know, they've also done very, very well, because I've met a lot of them there tonight, and, you know, quite a number of them have travelled back from the States, which is an indication as to the bond or the loyalty, you know, that they had with the school, that they should go to that expense and come back. So there was a great atmosphere in the place, and we tried to nurture that all the time, you know, that teacher-student relationship, that it should be developed and nurtured, because in a boarding school situation, it was a kind of them and us, it was the teachers and the pupils. There's a big, big divide, at least I always felt that. So for that reason, we worked extremely hard then to avoid that.
Now, as a teacher, your primary role was working with students, but yes. As a vice principal and principal, you would have been managing teachers and staff within the building. So how would you feel that the staff adapted to that style of education?
Strange enough, the staff there after the first year, they felt very much at home. They were under a certain amount of pressure to produce results, and they were conscious of that. We were all conscious of that, because in any system you've got to produce results today, and they achieved that, and there were never any opposition at any stage. They were very willing and very compliant. You know, we approached them in a fairly easy fashion. So you had a lot of committees working, and it was something that seemed to work well. And they were interested in the pupils and the pupil welfare. And we had a pastoral care structure that we set up, and it worked extremely well, and to the benefit of the pupils. So overall, like, discipline was good, and the attitude amongst the teachers was excellent.
So after 50 years now, what's your overriding memory of the St. Aidan's Comprehensive in Cootehill?
Well, I looking back on it, I've absolutely no doubt of what I heard back from the past pupils tonight, that it was a very successful venture. And I'm not saying that because I worked on it, because I could have worked elsewhere. But it was a successful venture, and I'm pleased to have been a part of it.
Mr. Jerry Brady is going to officially open our garden, and then we'll go into the polytunnel for the order of service.
No bother.
Without once submerging onto the banks of an urban morning, that hungers the first light much, much more than mountains ever do.
And she, like a ghost beside me, goes down with the ease of a dolphin and emerges unlearned, unshamed, unharmed. For she is the perfect creature, natural in every feature, and I am the geek with the alchemist stone.
For all of you must discover, for all who seek to understand, for having left the path of others, you'll find a very special hand. And it is a holy thing, and it is a precious time, and it is the only way. Forget me nots among the snow, it's always been, and so it goes, to ponder his death and his life eternally.
For all of you who must discover, for all who seek to understand, for having left the path of others, you'll find a very special hand. Precious time, and it is the only way. Forget me not among the snow, it always 1,000 years and still it goes to ponder his death and his life eternally.
Welcome you all to St. Aidan's Biodiversity Garden, Slea and Nodger, Nature's Way. The biodiversity theme for the next green flag we hope to earn involves increasing school awareness of the importance of biodiversity and finding ways to help biodiversity. We decided to do this through a school garden, a garden with predominantly native Irish plant species and specific habitats has been designed and developed in St. Aidan's. There is a woodland, a hedgerow, a wildlife meadow, a living wall, and a wetland. We have produced raised beds and an outdoor classroom, benches, and a composting area. Young people today engage in so many indoor activities, gaming and TV, and can have minimal connection to nature. If we can teach them that every animal and all nature and people have the right to life, we instill a respect and appreciation of nature. We hope our garden will in some way bring this appreciation of nature to our school community. So, a project like this and the scale that we took on does not happen without the hard work of so many people. Firstly, the management of St. Aidan's that have made wildlife and biodiversity a priority in our school on this, our 50th year. Mr. Barry Kavanagh from Nature's Patch that designed the biodiversity garden, the help and advice is invaluable. Our students have really enjoyed your talk on tree planting and they learned so much from you. Thank you. Our woodwork department. Our woodwork department, Mr. Fitzsimons and Mr. Keenan, have produced all the timber features in our garden. This was a huge ask of them in September, at the beginning of our school year, and they both worked tirelessly to produce our benches, our outdoor classroom, our living wall, raised beds, and the signage. All the work was done with a joke and in really good humour, and we enjoyed working with them. Our art department, Mrs. Gallagher, for the mosaics that she produced, they add colour and brightness to our garden, and thank you for those. And also, our sports department, Mr. Lennon, had a hammer, nails, and saw on Friday, and was giving it good and fixing everything up for us. It was very good. Thank you. Mr. Jerry Brady, a retired science teacher that worked on this project from the very beginning. In recent months, Jerry has also helped vamp up our planters, our flower beds, in preparation for the 50th celebrations. Every time myself and Mr. McCall arrived at school to do some work, we found Jerry already here, working, staking trees, planting daffodil bulbs. Thank you very much. Mr. McCall, who managed this project with myself, it was a welcome change to have somebody to work on a garden project with. You at all times kept me grounded in the theme of the garden, using natural materials, and the sign that you designed for the garden is perfect and so fitting. Thank you. So this morning we arrived here in the blustery weather and we had to kit this place out and everybody rode in. But a very special thanks to Miss Hannah, Miss Doherty, Mr. McQuillan, Miss Flanagan, Miss Nibwale, and many more who helped us sort everything out this morning and for organising today's service. To Coach Markey and the siblings, Colm and Aoife Shelby, for providing us with today's beautiful music. Thank you. Ken Thompson, our past pupils Jason Hall and Kieran Boylan, you arrived here in the summer to do a pitch. You thought you'd be gone here in a few days. You were here weeks later working on our garden and you did great work and you produced our garden. Your patience with an ever-evolving garden plan and your patience with the chestnut paling was fantastic. And finally, I would like to thank our army of students My fifth year horticulture class, Mr. Fitzsimons and Mr. Keenan's woodwork classes, my fifth year ag science class, and all the others that may not have had permission to be out there, but were there working anyway. and they worked very hard. I am in awe of the work that they did. At the beginning of this week, I was really worried that the garden would not be completed. Our students rode in and they did Trojan work. They dug holes, they pushed wheelbarrows. Some of the wheels were flat on the wheelbarrows and they were still pushing them. They carried logs, they raked soil, and all the time they had such good manners and they did anything that we asked of them. On Friday, we were finishing the garden off and Mr. Fitzsimons told a few students how proud he was of them. I would like to tell you all, you are a credit to your parents, your school, and your teachers. We are unbelievably proud of what you have achieved. With your help, you have developed a wildlife-friendly garden, a beautiful, relaxing space for students and staff of our school to enjoy for years to come. Well done.
And so as we come together this weekend to celebrate our past and look forward to the future, we seek God's blessing on this new biodiversity garden and on all who will work in it in the coming years. We will also dedicate a bench in remembrance of all deceased past students and staff of St. Aidan's Comprehensive. Lord, we turn to you seeking your guiding presence in our lives. Open our hearts to your goodness as we bring before you in prayer our hopes and dreams for this new garden and bench. Trusting in your merciful love, we make this prayer to you through Jesus our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him both of us have access in the one Spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundations of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. We ask you to bless this garden today. May it be a place where your designs for our students' lives are wisely discerned and nurtured. We ask your blessing for all those who took part in activities in this garden. May they be filled with your strength and peace as they labour to bring to fruition the plans that you inspire for our garden. May all who pass through its confines be filled with joy as they work and learn in the light of your Christian spirit. We make this prayer to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We gather together to ask God's blessing on the garden and to reflect our own blessings. We dedicate our efforts into this garden to the glory of God, to be used for God's purpose here on earth. Lord, hear us.
As all the earth is a garden, Lord, we ask that you bless this small piece of the earth as your light shines upon us and upon this garden, giving us life. Likewise, help us to give light and life to others. Lord, hear us.
Lord, We ask you, Lord, to bless the water that will nourish this garden. Help the roots of our plants tap into the life-giving water. Help us to be rooted in your love and in the holy water, Holy Spirit of the Lord, hear us.
We ask you, Lord, to bless the soil that nourishes new life in this ground and in this community. Help us look at all the mysteries of your work not yet seen. Help us to appreciate the nourishment of your earth and to use it wisely. Lord, hear us.
We ask you, Lord, to bless the seeds implanted here. Help them to spread and grow. Give all new life within this garden the right conditions to grow and bear fruit in your life, Lord, hear us. We ask you, Lord, for the knowledge, wisdom, and tools to best tend our garden and do your work to give life to ourselves and others, Lord, hear us.
Finally, Lord, we ask you that this garden may be a place of rest, a place to relax, a place to have fun, a place of peace and quiet time in a busy day for our students and staff, both present and into the future. Lord, hear us.
A garden reflection. Father of all gardeners, we thank thee that in the long ago you began the world in a garden. We thank thee for the morning and the singing of the bird. We thank thee for the quiet and the peace of eventide and the blessing of sleep that comes with the night. As we rise in the morning to work in our gardens, grant that the toil of our bodies may bring tranquility to our minds, that the growth of our plantings be exemplified in the growth of our souls, that the fruit of our trees be the perfect attainment, the crowning glory of a life dedicated to thee. Amen. And now I'd like to call on a friend of St. Aidan's, our past colleague, who is very much semi-retired this week, Mr. Jerry Brady, to come and dedicate our three benches.
There are three, my understanding is there are three benches out there, and they have each been dedicated. One has been dedicated to the past members of St. Aidan's community. One has been dedicated to the present community of St. Aidan's, and one has been dedicated to the future members of the Aidan's community. So here we go. On this weekend, Lord, where we remember the past, are conscious of the present, and also look forward to the future, let us take time to fondly remember those who have contributed to both this school and to our lives, who are no longer with us. Our present is the product of history. As we dedicate these benches, let us be thankful to the Lord for the people for whom these benches represent, the former students and teachers of whom many stories have been shared this past weekend. As our school looks forward to the future, may these benches in the garden become the venue where folk can gather to remember fondly and continue to share many happy memories of those no longer with us, but who made a lasting contribution to St. Aidan's, to the St. Aidan story and to our lives.
Reflection for a memorial bench. When death walks by with quiet tread, to touch a loved one who's then led away from sleep, away from pain, to wake in joy, to live again. You'll hear them on a whispered breeze, a calling bird in swaying trees. Do not weep long, but lift your eyes. You'll see their glory in God's skies. They'll be there in swallow's flight, their eyes in stars on a velvet night, their courage strong in every tree, their names carved for eternity. Hide not your love within their hearts, for they will always be a part of us and everything we do. for death is not when love is true.
Ken and Jason and myself do pray the final prayer. I just want to compliment Ms. Corbett and all involved in what we celebrate here today, especially the students that put so much work into it. I remember as a kid when I was during the summer holidays, and you'd be sent out to weed the garden and clean and sweep and all these wee jobs. But you'd run out, you'd be told to go out and weed the flower beds. So one way of getting out of the flower beds of weeding, because it was a horrible job, was to come in and say, "Mum, is that a weed or is it a flower?" So I'm not giving any ideas to students running into Miss Smith or whoever to say, "Is that a weed or a flower?" to get out of it. But it's a beautiful place, a place to relax, to find our roots, to get a sense and appreciation of the beauty of nature and to protect it. That it is a gift that we're given to be preserved and to be protected for generations yet to come. And here we'll cultivate that here in St. Aidan's. For all our intentions, spoken aloud and in the silence of our hearts, we pray an ecumenical prayer of blessing.
Lord God, you are the source of all light and the source of all love. You have created and formed each person here with the loving hand of care and the caring heart of friendship. So we give thanks to you for your interest in us and the blessings you give us in life.
Gracious God, protector of all, bless all students of St. Aidan's who work in this garden, where you are present among them. Guide and direct them as they prepare new life and grow to you, which will set them on a new course in their journey of life, and give them joy and hope for the future. Bless all at St. Aidan's who have given their time, support and encouragement for the facility before us today.
May the students of St. Aidan's forever find friends who will walk beside them, opportunities that will challenge and reward them, and love and support that will comfort them. May they always be confident in themselves and willing to serve others, and may you, Lord, bless them all the days of their future years. Lord, help them always to cultivate a future of faith, love, peace, and love. We make this prayer in faith through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our closing prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we praise you for your gift of this garden and the ability to use it wisely for work, rest, reflection, and play. We place our plans for this new area in your hands, trusting that with your guidance they will bear much fruit, We make this prayer to you in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
It was down in the Sally Gardens my love and I did meet. She passed the Sally Gardens with little snow white feet. She bid me to take life easy, to where the leaves grow on the trees. But I was young and foolish, and with her did not agree.
Have your patience for a few moments longer. If you're expecting now the burial of the time capsule, I'm afraid you missed it. Last Thursday night, a team of five men and a digger closed the lid on its cement sarcophagus, so it's already spent three nights underground, only 18,247 nights left to go. Instead, we will commemorate this moment by unveiling the exquisite silver quartzite capstone that will mark the burial site for the next 50 years, a fitting centerpiece to the biodiversity garden. But I'm here to talk about what's buried under it, the time capsule that you won't see buried and which I'm unlikely to see dug up. What's in it? A sealed plastic box, roughly 2 feet by 3 feet and 2 feet deep. It's filled with literally hundreds of letters from the pupils of today and addressed to the pupils of tomorrow. They describe their lives now and their interests. There are diagrams explaining the fashions of today and how Snapchat works. There are family photos and wishes for world peace, photos of our computers, photos of our smartphones, a copy of the commemorative magazine, the school timetables, school notices and 2 years back issues of the school newsletter. Copies of the Anglo-Celt, the Independent. Examples of student work, photocopies of our euro currency. One pupil wrote a 12-page letter to her grandchildren. Many, optimistically, wrote to themselves. Two students spent every registration class for 3 months last year drawing portraits of their classmates. My colleagues wrote to their counterparts on the staff of 2066. I wrote a letter to whoever opens it. The principal and the Minister for Education both have letters sealed inside. So what is a time capsule? Really, it's a vehicle. That may seem strange since it's going nowhere. But this vehicle travels not through space, but through time. While that plastic box, encased in concrete, sits completely still and undisturbed, the world above it will change. It's changed already in the last 3 days. Think of how different our world is today to that which saw the first foundations of this school being dug. The Cold War was at its height. Galway were all-Ireland champions, but would not be so again for another 32 years. The EU did not exist. Martin Luther King Jr. was still alive. Nelson Mandela had spent 2 years in jail. If you turned on your radio, Paperback Writer by the Beatles, Wild Thing by the Troggs, and You Can't Hurry Love were all number ones in 1966. The reigning world soccer champions were England. Imagine that. When you went shopping, you did it with punts and shillings. IBM had the world's biggest flash drive, allowing you to store 5 megabytes of data. But it would cost you $10,000 per megabyte. Just to put that into perspective, my USB cord, if I could take this back, I could sell it for $320 million. Nobody had heard of Facebook. Rap was what you did to Christmas presents. Isis was a character in Egyptian mythology. There were no footprints on the moon. But all this has passed. What will this place look like when the time capsule finally does see daylight? No one could possibly guess. But some things we do know. St. Aidan's will be celebrating its centenary. Perhaps this time capsule can form a part of their celebrations. I have suggested to the openers that they distribute our letters amongst their student body so that they might hear our voices from the past. But what then? They'll have an empty hole anyway. If they read our letters, if they can read our letters, then they will have proved that theory works. Perhaps they'll emulate our example. What might they say to the generations that follow them? And the B5 horticulture class, who we see sitting before you, have all prepared a small gift of wild flowers. As we go out now to unveil the commemorative capstone, B5 will now present you with this small token. Thank you.
Might not be able to get back up again.
You put that photo in, we will.
You'll be left
dig it up again.
It's fitting after the 50th anniversary celebrations of St. Aidan Comprehensive School that we speak to the person in charge now. Marianne, things have moved on from that opening day in 1966.
Yes, it has, but I would say to you that the foundations were set by the first principal, Breena Morga, who had a very clear vision of what comprehensive education should be. And following principals and deputy principals have brought their own stamp to the school, and as it has grown and developed, and it has become it is a really good school. Our curriculum has changed and broadened over the years. We have introduced new subjects for our students. There is a very clear pastoral care program in our school that would have started back in Breena Morga's time and has continued to develop and is becoming more and more important element of our school program.
Of course, comprehensive education, it was one of the first in Ireland, and that changed the whole thinking because it was co-ed, it was multi-denominational, and So has that ethos remained with the school?
Very much so. It's an education, co-educational. We have a wonderful rapport between boys and girls. In this school, actually, we would be almost half and half, boys and girls. It was an education. We have children from all different religious backgrounds. We also have a certain contingent of international students as well in our school that have really enriched our community over recent years. So yes, very much so, those principles have remained.
Education is in the news now, where the face of it is changing slightly. Would you feel that the comprehensive school in Cootehill is fit to match the expectations of education today?
Oh, without a doubt. We have wonderfully committed teachers who are very experts in their fields. But also, we have really taken on the challenge of developing our teaching and learning strategies over the years. ICT is now embedded in all our subject areas, and our teachers are very much about engaging our students in the learning process and constantly are introducing new strategies to help them to learn better.
So social media is an important part outside the school curriculum, and particularly with the age profile of the students here. So you feel that you're keeping a pace with that technology change?
Very much so, because really children will not stay focused anymore. Their attention span is shorter. So the traditional method of chalk and blackboard just won't work anymore. So you have to have a variety of strategies on hand to actually engage the learners in the classroom. And a very important part of the teaching in this school is the co-curricular activities, like the Young Scientist, Skyfest, those kind of things that actually develop children's skills of research, teamwork, that kind of thing.
And into the future, you feel that the Aidan Comprehensive is fit to keep pace with the modern teaching and educational trends?
Oh, very much so. And as part of our strategic plan, if you like, for the future, we became involved and are a pilot school for the new junior cycle. So we are constantly looking at what we are doing and planning for the future, very much so.
You're a very busy lady over the weekend. We appreciate you talking to us on Irish Web TV. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Thank you.